questions that I'll get asked here in the studio by my own private students is, you know, how long should I be practicing scales? You know, should it be 6 months or should it be 3 months? Or should it be a year or should I practice scales for 2 years or 3 years? You know, and, you know, there's really, it's a tough one to answer because there's really going to be different answers for different people. And, you know, the obvious answers of when pursuing anything that has to do with memorization on the guitar, you want to get it into a state of where you're really high awareness of it. And, you know, once you're into that high level of competency, when you developed a really good feeling for that level of skill with it, then, you know, some students are going to say, hey, that's cool. I've reached that pinnacle. I'm going to move on to other things with the scales. Maybe I'll go directly into composing now or whatnot. Other students maybe just won't feel that way and they feel like they just can't quit practicing scales. They need the technique up all the time. Now, is that good or is the other way good? You know, what's the approach with this that's going to be the best one? That's what we're going to discuss on this episode of the Guitar Blog Insider, what it actually takes to quote unquote finish the study of scales. Well, in getting started, we need to clarify that in order to complete your scale practice and reach a level of feeling like you're all wrapped up in learning the scales, it's going to take quite a long time. You know, probably a number of years to really get your scales down. There's a lot to learning the scale patterns, to memorizing them, to being able to use them, to improvise, to compose, and also you'll need to work everything up to a point where you've developed a high degree of skill, really high degree of competency with the shapes from a technical direction, so that when you're using them, your mind is completely focused on music and not on how the fingers have to move, the physical attributes. That physical stuff needs to be all at the unconscious level. So what we're gonna do in this video is we're going to analyze all of this in stages of development from stage one, which would be committing the shapes to memory. Now, your first goal with any new scale pattern should be committing that pattern to memory. And this is actually very similar to learning a song's guitar riff. You know, once you no longer need to look at the tab of a song that you're working on and you're playing the song from memory, you've committed it to your unconscious mind. And this is exactly what you'll want to do with a scale pattern that you're learning. You know, commit it so that you can sit with your guitar playing the scale just by staring at your fingerboard and then eventually just playing it where you don't even have to look at your fingerboard anymore at all. You just going to reach that stage of where it's automatic. You know, let's say you can take a scale and you can play it and talk to somebody and maybe hold a conversation with your mom or your dad or your sister or your brother, friends, and it doesn't have to have your, you know, your conscious mind there. It's all unconscious. It's automatic. So if you can get to that stage where you don't really need to look at your hands anymore, you don't need to look at a piece of paper anymore with the diagram of the scale on it, you could pretty much talk to somebody or, you know, talk into a video camera like this and play the scale effortlessly, then you've reached that first stage, which is that unconscious level of competence. Well, the next stage involves what a lot of guitar players would simply call woodshedding. That's where you're going to sit there committed to the scale, you know, once the scale is memorized, of course, and get going on practicing it for hours and hours over months and months of practice so that you become technically proficient. You know, the competency level goes up way high on it. And the main goal within this stage of scale study is being able to run the scale through all the primary note durations. So that's going to include, even if you want to, starting at quarter notes, although that's going to be a little boring if you already have the scale memorized and it's not bad under your fingers. I'd probably suggest starting at eighth notes and then moving on to 16th notes and then start developing triplet feel as well. Get the eighth note triplet going on in there and the 16th note triplets, although you probably will find that very quick to study. That's going to really bust your chops on your picking level as well. So through this stage, though, you're best off practicing this with a metronome. You could use a drum machine, but my suggestion would be to use a metronome set at a very basic click. Don't get any kinds of, you know, regimented clicks in there where they're accenting one or accenting feels of triplets or 16th notes or anything like that. Have it be a very basic click track. I'm going to turn my metronome on here. It's set at 76 beats per minute right now. You notice that click? It's just basic. It just sounds like somebody tapping on a piece of wood. So just keep it really simple. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take an A major scale, and I'm just gonna start by doing eighth notes with it. So here's my count, and I think it's a really good idea to pace yourself in. So one, two, three and four and one and two and three and four and. Keep a good, steady pace. Have everything feel real perfect against the click. Now what we're gonna do next is move up to 16th notes. So with 16th note feel, we're gonna have groups of four over one. One, two, three and a, four and a. Okay, so really get that perfectly in time, have it feel natural to you, that you're not stressing to be able to do it. And if it feels stressed to do, turn the metronome down. You know, don't go faster than you can play it perfectly. Let's move on though to eighth note triplets. So this is where we're gonna have three attacks over one. So here's the count again. One, two, three, and a, four, and a, one, and a, two, and a, three, and a, four, and a, one, and a, two, and a, three. All right? So now we're gonna move on to 16th note triplets. Now 16th note triplets, remember, is six over one. This is where it gets pretty darn fast. So pace yourself in at the beginning. Get that feel down pat. So here's an example of that. So. You notice in the feel there, it's perfect with the six over one. You can hear it going one, two, three, four, five, six, da, 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 da. You know, it's really in time. With fast tempos like that, pace yourself in first. You know, it's gonna be really difficult to play the scale if you don't have that pace down. Then what you're gonna do is run through the scale, and we're gonna go through it in groups of three so it feels easy under the fingers. So one, two, three, four. You can tell it's really fast. It's tough to keep up to that tempo for anyone who doesn't have some good technical proficiency. And I was only going at 76. I'd probably really recommend at least pushing it up into the around the 90s. If you want to go faster, that's fantastic. You're kind of getting into that Paul Gilbert level of shred chops. But if you want that level of playing, this is how you do it. You know, a lot of times people will email me and ask me certain questions about speed picking and playing fast and all that stuff. Comes down to the metronome. You know, if you want to be able to do that, just turn the metronome on, do this stage, and hammer it out for, if you have to, years. You know, I remember going to a clinic with Al Di Meola. If you don't know who Al Di Meola is, he's one of the world's great fast speed pickers. He said he worked on his picking. When I was at, this is a clinic I went to with him. This is him talking. This isn't anything I read or anything like that. He worked on his picking technique for 3 years. He dedicated while he was going to Berklee College of Music. He said he locked himself literally in a closet and he just hammered it out, worked on it like crazy. And you know, this is kind of the level that you need to get at if you want to have really high degree and a level of competency and those shred tactics, you know, if you're into that style of playing. It's just really the pinnacle of getting all that together. So stage two, really important stage, wood shedding and building your skills up to that high level of proficiency. Well, the third stage of scale development is application. And once you know the shape and you can play it without relying upon a chart or a tab, and once you have some technical competency with it, it's time to begin applying the scale in some type of musical situation. This could be something as simple as a three chord or maybe a four chord loop that relates back to the key center of the scale. So maybe let's say you were studying major scales and you decided upon studying a major scale for that day's work, and you decided to work on a simple loop of some chord changes is in A major. Well, you know, 1-4-5 progressions work fantastic. They're easy for your ear to relate to. You can usually hear some nice movements in your mind and, you know, link up to what's happening with the scale run and so forth. So let's say, you know, I just started on A major chord for the A major scale, and, you know, that's obviously the one chord, and then I like changes in 1-4-5s that move directly to the 5. I find that's a really nice sound. And then we're gonna move to the 4. And then back to the one. So that's gonna be our progression. A to the E chord, over to the D chord, and then take it back to the A. Now, I've already got all these changes into a loop pedal, and I'm gonna fire that up and just fool around a little bit, give you a good idea what's happening with application. Remember, that's step three, application of the scale. So here's the loop. Let me just fool around a little bit for you. Thank you. So you can tell, you know, I'm just fooling around with a couple of sections of this of the neck. I'm not really doing anything too crazy. I'm not looking at the entire span of the fingerboard or anything. I'm just kind of locking down a little bit of a region and trying to make music, trying to, you know, execute ideas I'm trying to hear in my mind and just bring it all out into the open, you know, because it's one thing to have scales under your fingers and that you've woodshedded and there's some competency there maybe with your chops, technical proficiency there, but making music is different. Remember in stage one, we were discussing how important it is to get that scale to the point where you don't think about the shape anymore. It's all automatic, or what we called unconscious competence. So we're at that level now where our mind can be on music. It doesn't have to be on what our fingers have to do to execute the scale shape. That's totally programmed in. And then stage two, remember, is when you move up with the scale to that level of technical proficiency. You can do rapid changes through 16th notes into maybe some kind of triplet run, and then you can get back into maybe some kind of an eighth note part. Maybe you can do some ideas in there that are a bit syncopated, all that kind of jazz. And then now we're on stage three of all this, where we're trying to get application. We're trying to make music. We're looking at some chord changes, looking at some harmonies that are going by, and we're trying to execute some musical content now. You know, so remember, this is where you're trying to execute ideas that are in your mind. You're trying to get concepts out that are in the back of your brain and musical flow, whether it's, you know, ideas you hear that are ascending, ideas that are descending, maybe some kind of sequenced pattern, whatever it may be. So lock it up in just a small fretboard region, because this is a stage that's more about tapping your brain for those musical statements rather than, you know, learning large swaths of the neck so that you have this, you know, total command of the fingerboard. We're going to get to that. That's coming up. But stage three is just simplistic application. Remember, we're tapping into our mind and we're trying to find those musical flowing statements and get them out live, you know, just get them into reality so that we start tapping this idea that we're becoming more and more musical with that scale. Well, the fourth stage of scale practice involves reaching a point at where mapping the whole neck with the scale that you're studying is really well developed. I'll often refer to this with my own students as getting the scale so well developed on the neck in any key signature that no matter what key you're in, the whole neck feels like just one big friendly place for that scale in that key, whatever key or scale that that might happen to be. You'll want to have maximum control and a really high level of awareness, and of course, good technical competency with the scale shapes, no matter where you are on the neck, where you're going to be with whatever key. It's just going to feel incredibly easy to perform phrases and do melodies and lines and licks. Now, you can practice this in a lot of different ways, and one of the easiest things is, you know, we were using a lot of A major scale in this video. You know, just work out scale layouts all over. You know, you could go to the A and start thinking, well, how does it feel in, you know, one zone of the neck? You know, how does it feel down in lower registers? You know, how's it in the mid register? How does it work when you move up to higher registers? You know, move into even higher registers, maybe even on an acoustic where it's kind of uncomfortable to play. You know, get into regions where it just feels like, oh man, this is crazy. And, you know, try and work there a little bit. Then move into, you know, from a jump from a high register into a low register, you know, play a line. You know, move to different regions. All kinds of, there's so much work that you could do with this. It can be just crazy, you know, how many hours you can spend working on it. And, you know, like I was saying, you can use different kinds of lines, different licks. You can practice it in a whole bunch of different ways. But work at this stage in thinking in terms of laying a fantastic foundation down for combinations of ways that you work. You could work physically with a lot of scales and, you know, organizing leads and mapping out, you know, composed ideas on the neck. You could grab a piece of paper, you know, fretboard diagram paper, and organize different ways and original layouts of the scales. You could do three note per string scales. You could work on sequencing concepts, you know, where you're doing kind of like a mathematical structure with the scale. And this kind of thing. There's lots of them, you know. all this kind of stuff. It's just, man, there's so much you could do with this. It's just crazy. But it's reaching this point where the scale is well developed. And then there's even another leg on this too, of looking in terms of analyzing of other people's solos. You know, you could go to analyze for, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks, you could analyze Eric Clapton and then move over to looking at David Gilmour. And then you could go and look at Jimmy Page. And then you can go into a big, you know, I don't know, kick with somebody else, you know, Joe Satriani, whoever. You know, you could go into some AC/DC stuff with Angus Young. You know, the list is endless because there's so many great guitar players out there. It's crazy, you know, how much stuff you could practice. Probably never even do it all in one lifetime, but you could pick a good collection, maybe a half dozen of people to start with, and just dive into their playing, dig in deep to what they do, how they use scales, how they're executing ideas on the neck, and use that information as a way to compose your own original melodic ideas of what you would be doing on your own. I mean, if you study a good, you know, branch out, do a good segment of the guitar playing population of the Guitar Hero guys out there, and, you know, utilize what you like out of, you know, one person. You could maybe pick something that you like from a Hendrix lead, and you could pick something out of a Clapton lead, and you could pick something that Jimmy Page did, and you can, you know, even, it doesn't matter who it is, you could just, you know, look at those different players and incorporate what they're doing into your own original ideas, and this is what's going to slowly build your own style, because you're going to gravitate to those guitar players to study that you enjoy, you know, so those people, whoever that might be, maybe it's, Yngwie Malmsteen, or maybe it's Paul Gilbert, or some of the other shredder guys, and you're going to incorporate bits and pieces of everybody you study into building your own playing style. And in the end, you're going to sound like you, which is super important, but at the same time, you'll have branched out and tested other people's concepts and the way that they use the guitar neck and scales, and that'll be, a, you know, bits and pieces of all that will be incorporated into what slowly becomes you and your own special style. So stage four is a really important stage because it's a big mapping stage of the whole system and that big development stage, so that you're getting the scale well developed on your neck in a lot of different manners. You know, you're looking at how it's all across the fingerboard spread out, how you're using it, building your own original style, mapping out other people's style. You know, this is a fantastic level because it really is where you start honing in on becoming what you are as a individual, as a guitar player. You know, every musician will tend to look off into the future when it comes to the development of their skills. We're only human, and part of human nature is definitely understanding the conclusion, you know, what everything we're involved with is going to end up as. You know, without it, we're left with what psychologists call an open loop, and unfortunately, this open loop theory is where we tend to be with learning scales over a very long time. You know, the problem, in one sense, is how much initial physical and memory work is involved with learning scale patterns. There's actually so much work involved that a lot of guitar players, they start and stop with learning scale shapes over months and months, sometimes even years, until they finally commit. You know, they get frustrated and they say, all right, enough's enough. No matter what, I'm learning all the scales and that's it. You know, and that's really the place, you know, that I guess a guitarist needs to get to in order to fully commit to the four stages, you know, that I discussed, and, you know, reach that final point of just finishing their scale studies once and for all. Well, I'd like to end the discussion by saying thanks for joining me. If you want to learn more about what I do as an online guitar teacher, then head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for your free lifetime membership. When you want more, you can always upgrade to either a basic or premium lesson package and start studying the guitar courses I've organized for the members of my website. Also, I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on all this in the comments section below. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more. Thanks again. And we'll catch up next week for another episode of the Guitar Blog Insider. When it comes to online guitar lessons, there's no place better than creativeguitarstudio.com. General membership to the site is always free, and paid memberships to access our step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced guitar programs are offered in reasonable monthly and annual packages. Skype lessons are also available if you need more specific instruction one-on-one to discuss the finer details of your guitar playing. Sign up today at creativeguitarstudio.com. I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.